Okay, cytokine storm also. I just to focus this slide once again, because this is very important. That means since Ayurveda, homeopaths, and we all Ayush system of medicine focusing on the immunity, we should know much about this one actually, why the cytokine storms occurs and other thing. So this is played by cytokines, interferons, JAK proteins, and STAT proteins. So the cytokines get attached to the cytokine receptor of the cell, but since the molecule is big, the cytokines cannot pass through the cell. But they will do a harm, like how an ant bite on your skin. The ant is not passing, but it can pass the its poison. Like that cytokines will this will attract JAK proteins. So it will get attached to the intracellular portion of the cytokines. Get it phosphorylated. Then this phosphorylated JAK protein, that is means Janus kinase, that will stimulate the STAT proteins. It will phosphorylate the STAT protein. STAT protein is signal transducer and activator of transcription. That means it is transducing the signal from the cytoplasm into the nucleus, and it activates the transcription. Transcription means production of the genes get activated and producing the proteins. That is the transcription. So this STAT proteins will move to the nucleus. It will reach the nucleus and it will get attached to the codons, or the we call it the template of the messenger RNA. Then it will start doing this transcription, start producing more interleukins, like interleukin 2, 6, 7. So that this is the this leads to cascade of reaction. So cytokine, this leads to cytokine storm. That's why I put some pictures to understand it easily. So this is the whole phenomenon, because too much of lymphocytes are being damaged because of the virus, but that again causes leads to cytokine reaction, because it is from the our own host inflammatory reaction leading to cytokine storms. Okay, so we are moving to the clinical syndrome. Before, we have seen the clinical staging or the clinical evolution of SARS-CoV-2 leading to COVID-19 disease. Stage 1 is like an early phase. Second stage is a preliminary phase. Third phase is the hyperinflammatory stage. So this is the presentation. It can be an uncomplicated illness. It can be a mild pneumonia, or it can be a severe pneumonia, or it leads to acute respiratory distress syndrome, ARDS. Or it can be seen with sepsis, or that leads to septic shock, respiratory failure, cardiac failure, and death. So this is the sixth clinical syndrome of SARS-CoV-2. Majority of the patients, 80% of the patients, fall into this group of uncomplicated illness. Rest 20 will be distributed to the mild pneumonia, severe pneumonia, and ARDS group. And 5% move to sepsis and septic shock, especially old age people who are diabetic, who are in blood thinners, or who are on medications for cardiac problems, or some studies say they are having taking AC2 receptor inhibitor. Those who are taking AC2 receptor inhibitor, their body will produce more AC2 receptors, and the confrontation of the receptor will be more active, and it will attract the virus. So there are many hypotheses like that. Okay, then now we move to uncomplicated illness, we know what are the symptoms producing. All system have their own mode of treatment. When it moves to the second stage, especially pneumonia. So from Wuhan, they identified an unknown pneumonia. So this is the hallmark of COVID-19 due to SARS-CoV-2. So what are the typical changes in X-ray in COVID-19 patients? The finding, the radiology say GGO. GGO means ground glass opacity. That's the term they're using. GGO, ground glass opacity, GGO. Okay, so there could be, for the first 4 to 5 days, as we have seen before, there won't be any respiratory involvement. There won't be any lung involvement. So there, if you take the X-ray on day one, it will not show there. So majority of them, they will show it around 10 to 12 days, or it will begin from day 6 or day 7. So the timing of X-ray is most important. If you diagnose a patient by RT-PCR on day one, and if you take an X-ray, the X-ray will be normal. That means we cannot rule it out. That is, we can do stage by stage only. On 7th day, mostly they are doing it on 7th day. If you take an X-ray on 7th day, then only you can see the GGO appearance. That's the ground glass opacity. So, and the peculiarity is that this will be mostly bilateral and it is peripheral. So, the peculiarity of this ground glass appearance, it is mostly bilateral and it will be peripheral also, not the near to the center of the lung or towards the heart. It is to the periphery, near to the outer side of the lung only. So that is the most important finding. either GGO, that is ground glass opacity, or consolidation. Both of them will appear peripherally and mostly bilaterally, either right lobe or left lobe, but majority both of them, both lower lobes will be affected. Then this returns chest X-ray findings have a lower sensitivity than initial RT-PCR testing. RT-PCR will explain later. So it is 69 versus 91. You can see that now the sensitivity or the specificity of RT-PCR is around 95. That means even we can diagnose 5% as false positive or false negative. In by X-ray, we can diagnose up to 60 to 70% only. But this is a very important finding. It's GGO, ground glass opacity. Right side, put on the right side, you can see a normal X-ray. On the left side, you can see, this is left, no? Okay. So on the left side, you can see the GGO, that's a ground glass opacity. So you look closely, because many of us are confused of how to diagnose this ground glass appearance and the normal. So I think this slide will help you to differentiate it clearly. These are all hilar markings, that is normal. But you can see, what is the ground glass means? If you crush the glass into fine pieces, it's like a if you spread on a paper, you can see like this one. So this is clearly visible in this X-ray. This appearance, you can see the normal lung here. See the normal. Compare this to this one. X-ray is like you need to have an X-ray I2 to diagnose an X-ray. So this is the ground glass opacity. This is a normal X-ray. But they are advising CT scan also. In CT scan, it is pretty clear. So this is the ground glass opacity. You can see a well-marked area here. See, this much is consolidated, or this is affected with the what happens in why ground glass appearance occurs? It is because the carbon dioxide cannot be exhaled. So what the carboxyhemoglobin will go, the level go high. So there will be fluid exudate collecting in the alveoli and terminal bronchioles. So they give a appearance like grounded glass or finely crushed glass. So you can well demarcate it. So this is the normal inner portion of the lung. This is the ground glass appearance of the outer portion of lung in CT scan. So you can see these isolated patches of ground glass appearance. That means it's affecting certain portions of the lung. But the typical finding is, as I said, it's in the peripheral part of the lung and it is bilateral. And either consolidation or the ground glass appearance. I hope now it is clear with the X-ray also. Otherwise, we simply say, okay, this is ground glass appearance. We will not be able to differentiate or appreciate it. That's why I have put a slide of comparison. This is a normal X-ray and this is a ground glass appearance. Okay, now moving to, this is the study based on 121 X-ray patients with COVID-19. And they have mentioned everything clearly. So you can see, this one, this is like a yearly X-ray. That means if you take in 2 days X-ray, then it's clear for you, no? So the other one is like, the X-ray is intermediate. This is the intermediate color of X-ray, 3 to 5 days. Then late X-ray, 6 to 12 days. This one is if it is taken on 6 to 12 days. So the chances of normal chest CT. This is based on the CT scan actually. So if you take it on second day, 56% will be normal only. But the major important findings in intermittent late days, you can see consolidation will be there, bilateral disease will be there, and the distribution is in peripheral. So peripheral, peripheral, bilateral, peripheral, consolidation, or GGO, ground glass opacity. That is the, see, it's not exclusively for SARS-CoV-2. In viral pneumonia, the presentation is most similar. But since we are dealing with a pandemic, whoever comes with the bilateral, peripheral, ground glass opacity, they diagnose it as SARS-CoV-2 unless and until it is disproved. So bilateral, peripheral consolidation or ground glass opacity is the hallmark of viral pneumonia, especially in this pandemic, it is of COVID-19. But they did a study on 121 patients. You can see that the frequency of everything is explained there. Right upper lobe is 44%, right middle lobe 41%, right lower lobe 65%, right upper lobe 14%, left lower lobe 63%. That means right lower and left lower, because mainly lower bilateral, lower lobe, peripheral ground glass opacity is the hallmark of this one. And since we homeopaths have specific medicine, like if you have affection on the right lower lobe or left lower lobe, So this can be useful for our medicine selection also. Then now they have explained this. Either both granulomas opacity or consolidation. Consolidation will look appear like a white thing. I can show you that. See, this is like a, we can say this is a hard shadow, but still, so consolidation will be like this white one, but the granulomas will be like a crushed piece of glasses. So either it can be a consolidation or it can be a granulomas appearance. Especially in viral pneumonia, granulomas appearance is more because there can be what you call air bubbles trapped there. There will be what you call carbon dioxide also will be there. Then the inflammatory exudates will be there. So more towards the granulomas appear opacity or consolidation. So it is clear. Now, extra part is clear because this is a hallmark of COVID-19: bilateral, peripheral, granulomas opacity or consolidation. Okay, now we are moving to the most important thing, that is ARDS severity based on hypoxia. As you know, death occurs mainly in old age patients or those who are having what you call respiratory illness like respiratory complaints like COPD or asthma or heart failure, anything related with anything increasing the pressure in the lung can leads to complications. So we have seen that we finding this one called based on a ratio called PF ratio, that is we can see PaO2 bar FiO2. I have told in the beginning, so this PaO2 is the partial pressure of oxygen, partial pressure of arterial oxygen. This is determined by ABG, arterial blood gas analysis. And FiO2, if the patient is breathing himself or if you are breathing atmosphere air, that's a fraction of inspired oxygen is 21%. So since partial pressure of arterial oxygen is measured in millimeters of mercury, this PF ratio will also be in millimeters of mercury. So in normal, it should be above 300. Normal individual will be around 400. So if it goes based on the value of PF ratio, if it is between 200 to 300, this is called mild hypoxia. If it is between 100 to 200, it is called moderate hypoxia. If it is severe, that means if it is less than 100, it's called severe hypoxia. What is the significance of doing this classification or this criteria? This outcome of the patient depends on the severity of the hypoxia. That means if the hypoxia is mild, that means if the PF ratio, that is partial pressure of arterial oxygen versus fraction of inspired oxygen is between 200 to 300, 27, that means around 1/3, 30% of patients will die even they are supported by the ventilator. In moderate hypoxia, if the PF ratio is between 100 to 200, that is also around 30-35% of patients will die. But if it goes to severe hypoxia, that means if the PF ratio is less than 100, half of the patients will die even they are on mechanical ventilation. So that is the reason why the mortality is very high in SARS-CoV-2, because it leads to hypoxia. And it is, there are other reasons, like if you are since the partial pressure of oxygen goes down, means your lung is not able to breathe. That is why even Ayurveda also, they are suggesting, yoga also, they are suggesting to do breathing exercise, pranayama, do maximum oxygenation of your anatomical dead spaces. So this is very, very important. So you should understand this slide and know how the hypoxia is classified. It is classified based on the PF ratio. If PF ratio, that means the partial pressure of arterial oxygen divided by a fraction of inspired air. If it is between 200 to 300, it is mild. If it is between 100 to 200, it's moderate. If it is more than 100, if you get a report the patient's hypoxia or the PF ratio is more than 100, less than 100, that means if severe hypoxia, half of the patient may die. That leads to complications like heart failure, liver, lung failure, everything. So that is the most important thing. And just shown this one, see, when it goes to mechanical ventilation, a team of doctors is very important that we then need to endotracheal intubation to place the the ventilator portions to see, we can give oxygen. The management is like in mild cases, or see, I forgot to tell you one more thing. See, always it is difficult to measure the partial pressure of oxygen, but we have a pulse oximeter. it's very mandatory in Dubai also. You have to have a pulse oximeter clinic. You know, just like it's like a clip they can put on the finger, you can measure the partial pressure of oxygen. Normal, that's called SpO2. It has to be above 95%. But if it falls below 90%, chances of hypoxia is very high. So whenever you get a chance to get a respiratory patient with respiratory complaints, or now any patient with fever, do the partial pressure of oxygen, do the pulse oximeter test. If it is more than 95, it's okay, well and good. It is up to 90, it's okay, but you have to be very careful. If it goes less than 90, that means you have to immediately send the patient for ICU care. So in some cases, they will do the calculation based on the saturation pressure of oxygen also. So that is more important. So initial stage, if there is no hypoxia, but the patient have a deep breathing problem, you have seen the PF ratio more than 300, say 350, then no need to go for the ventilation. But yes, strict observation is important. Why? Because any time, in an hour, within 1 hour, the patient can go from mild to moderate to severe hypoxia. So that is why any patient with a severe respiratory difficulty, ask them to get admitted in a hospital with a tertiary level for ICU care. So up to that case, like if there is only difficulty breathing, but there is no hypoxia, PF ratio is normal, you can give them oxygen. Normal oxygen, you can give at 5 liters per minute. Or if you want to give a face mask, like oxygen with a mask, the up to 15 to 20 liter per minute you can give. That is called high flow nasal catheter oxygenation. But if it fails or the patient will move to mild hypoxia, immediately send the patient for ICU care. Because once the onset of hypoxia starts, as I told you, in an hour it can go from mild to moderate, moderate to severe, and it's very, the progress is very fast. So that should be taken care. So I think this part is clear. Like now we have seen the X-ray, then we have diagnosed the findings, how the appearance, ground glass appearance, ground glass opacity. Then we know how to manage the patient in with ARDS. Now we are moving to the most important part of diagnosis. Many times doctors are confused which is taken, whether the swab is taken for what, or the blood is taken, how the rapid test, how the PCR is done. So the most important diagnosis based on these three tests only for SARS-CoV-2 and COVID-19. But if they have other comorbidities, we will do other investigations also. The basic test is RT-qPCR, IgM and IgG. This RT-qPCR is called, this small R called real time. This RT is reverse transcriptase. This qPCR is quantitative polymerase chain reaction. So that is why the big name RT-qPCR. I do repeat it. Real time reverse transcriptase quantitative polymerase chain reaction. So simply we say PCR test. Why real time? There are different types of reverse transcriptase test. One is real time, then is nested, multiplex. There are different methodology to do that. So why reverse transcriptase? As we know, this is a RNA virus. So the PCR test is based on a DNA test. So we have to convert that RNA into DNA. So we make complementary DNA from this RNA. So we are doing a process called reverse transcription. Or normally transcription is done from DNA to RNA. Here we are doing RNA to DNA. That is why it's called reverse transcriptase. So real-time RT, that means real-time reverse transcriptase. From this messenger RNA of SARS-CoV-2, we are making complementary DNA. Then we go for a quantitative polymerase chain reaction. Here, say we have, we got 100 messenger RNA of SARS-CoV-2. We do the PCR to augment it, we'll amplify it. From 100, we make 10,000. So there is a ratio based on the, what you call it. There are patterns. Like, you know, if you get 10,000 complementary DNA by amplification, then you can, there is a ratio. Like if it is 1:10,000, that means one virus is present. Or if you get 1 million, there will be 10,000 virus will be present in the patient. So based on that, we will diagnose the presence of virus in the body. So this is to identify the presence of SARS-CoV-2 on the body. It's for the test for the virus. Then the other two tests is our reaction, our antibody, IgM and IgG, immunoglobulin M and immunoglobulin G. Immunoglobulin M means immediate, IMM. So easy to remember, IgM, immediate. Immediate in the sense, the moment the virus enters the body, IgM may not be present. Maybe it will take another 5 to 7 days. But comparing to IgG, it is immediate. That is why we named it as IgM immediate, followed by IgG. IgG normally develop after 14 days. So the first test to be positive will be RT. We can say simply PCR test. Then in by around 5th day or 7th day, IgA will be positive. By around 14th day, IgG will be positive. So that part is clear, no? So the, these are the three tests, RRP-qPCR, IgM and IgG. Okay, then I'll just show you how we are doing the test. We will collect the swab either from the nose or from the throat or from the alveolar fluid. If you have the patients on ventilator, they will get the fluid. So anything is collected. And they will go for a lysis of the swab will be lysed, and then we will get messenger RNA of the virus from that one. Then we will, this is an RT-PCR machine. They will feed that into the machine. The other thing will be taken care of the machine, care by the machine. You can see different methods. There is one step RT-PCR, there is two step RT-PCR. Same thing, it's from the messenger RNA. We do the reverse transcriptation to make the first strand of complementary DNA, that's called cDNA. So from the messenger RNA, we synthesize cDNA, then we will amplify it. From one side, there are this like, this can be done in one step, means from the same place, they will add DD and TP and all. That's called nucleated proteases also to augment the production of cDNA. So everything in DNA, it will be put in a one tube and they will do the one step PCR. So we will get amplified number of complementary DNA, cDNA of the messenger RNA. I think it is clear for you. But in two step, what they will do? They will do the first step, then they will add specific primers and then do the amplification. So collect the swab either from the nose or from the throat or from the alveolar fluid, do the lysis with the buffer, collect the messenger RNA, feed into the RT-PCR chamber. The other thing, it's like a colorimetry. This is based on lighting and everything. I don't want to explain details about the mechanism, but actually you should know this one. So we will get the result report. That means the virus is present in the body. So we are measuring the augmented complementary DNA of the virus, but the original messenger RNA, we make it into complementary DNA. It's clear for you. So this is RT-PCR test, and this is from the swab, either from the throat or from the nose or from the alveolar fluids. Then this is the, some will say we are going to do the rapid test, and the sensitivity and specificity varies based on the test kit which you are using. That is when Indian Council of Medical Research, they rejected that kit we got from China, which were using in Jaipur. They stopped the rapid test and other thing. But PCR is time consuming and it's very costly also. But this is like, we are familiar with the UP, urine pregnancy test. Just to put the urine or the blood sample, we can measure the beta HCG. Like that, they made, this is so easy to do the IgG test. I mean immunoglobulin, IgG and IgM, both can be done. So I will show you. So this is, I think before some WhatsApp group, they shared, this is the the vaccine for the SARS-CoV-2, but this is the kit for doing the test. This is the reagent we are adding into that. So from the needle, like how we are doing the for our glucometer or for the UPT test. We have 10 more minutes. Okay, so you can see the marking here. So we'll feed into the feeding place, then add the reagent, then the result will be given. C is the control, G is for IgG, and M is for IgM. So if the patient is not infected, it will be negative. IgM will be positive within 5 or 7 days, then appear the IgG. So around 15 or 20 days, it will be both IgG and IgM will be positive. So I just again narrating that you can see a window period, then a decline and convalescent stage. So window period around 1 to 5 days, the patient will be mostly asymptomatic, but majority of patients remain asymptomatic throughout the illness also. They are also, that's what I told you, know, this is the difficulty in controlling this infection actually. But by around 5th day, they will start developing the symptoms. But you can see this represents the virus actually. This is, or we can say RT-PCR test. From the moment the virus is infected, if you are able to get the swab clearly, we can find the presence of virus through the PCR test. That means PCR test should be positive from day one till the complete virus is eliminated from the body. Then by around 5th day, you can see the IgM antibody become detectable. And by around 21st day, that means around 14 or 15 days, it will be there in the blood. IgM will be disappearing. Very rarely it will be positive to another 1 week or more. Then by around 14th day, IgG will start developing and it will remain there for we don't know forever or what is the duration of IgG persisting. Then there are reports where people are getting reinfected also. So we don't know exactly that. So try to understand this chart, then it will be clear. Suppose if you are doing the test on 5th day, only PCR will be positive, IgM and IgG will be negative. If you are doing it on the 13th day, PCR will be positive and IgM will be positive, but IgM will not be positive. But if you are doing around 21st day, so you can see PCR will be positive, IgM will be positive, IgG will be positive. Like that, based on this chart, we can interpret the results also. So this is again showing clearly, that means the incubation period is around 14 days. The infectivity also in between that, but even without symptoms also, patients can transmit the disease to others. And the maximum virus load is in between 14 to 21 days. Then maximum incubation period is around 24 days. Then some patients will remain convalescent up to 40 days. That means their PCR will be positive up to 40 days. You can see IgM will be positive from 5th day to 21 days. IgG will be positive from 14 to till the virus is over. But the IgG will be persisting. The level will be persisting in the blood. So this chart is also very important. We have explained everything clearly. Can you turn off that audio also? Captain, can you mute that? So this is also, you can just take a photograph or I will upload it in the YouTube. See, this is the PCR positive. That means day one, the virus is there. But IgM and IgG is negative. That means just the virus entered the body. So the patient may be in the window period of infection. There won't be any symptoms also. So, but with RT-PCR only, we will be able to identify that patient is infected. Then start developing IgM. That means the patient is in the early stage of infection. IgG is not present there. Then the third one, PCR is positive, IgM is positive, IgG is positive. That means patient is in the active phase of infection. Then what happens? By 21 the day, IgM will be negative, but PCR will be positive and IgG will be positive. That means the patient may be in the later or it can be due to recurrent stage of infection. Then the next stage, here PCR is negative, but IgM is present. If IgM is present, that means the patient is infected. The PCR can go false negative. That means you have to redo the test. As I told you, the sensitivity is only 90%, 95%, 5% group. So if IgM is positive, definitely the virus will be there. Then this is the stage where PCR is negative, IgM is negative, IgG is positive. That means the patient, there is no virus in the body, there is no IgM in the body, only IgG present. That means the patient had a past infection, is completely cured, and we can discharge the patient because there is no PCR. That means there is no virus, IgM is completely gone, only IgG is positive. This will be, you can see patients coming to your clinic after 3 months or 6 months. If you do the IgG test for SARS-CoV, it will be positive, IgG, but there won't be any IgM. Clear? Then another thing, another report we are getting sometimes, IgM will be positive, IgG will be positive, but PCR will be negative. That is also maybe a false negative report. So two things to be done properly, PCR and IgM at least. If both are positive, then we cannot discharge the patient. If both are negative, or PCR and IgM is negative, we can discharge the patient because either by infection or by vaccination only we will get IgM. If there is no IgG. If there is no IgG, it's not a big thing. But if there is no IgM immediate and PCR is negative, then you can discharge the patient. But majority will get IgG since they are infected. So it is clear, no? So just to go through the slide once again, it's very easy to understand based on this graph actually. Then other tests to the comorbid, just to mention early advance, we all discussed about this one. This is the homeopathy part. I think since we have other specialties also, I don't discuss much about that. Then this is the way how we are getting the report. They will show this one like 2019 NCoV detect in the blood. Then once they are discharging, they will do the novel corona RNA PCR swab, that's one throughout swab, not detect. This is to be done. They have to do repeated three times PCR negative plus IgM negative. That is the protocol to discharge a patient. Three PCR negative and last one IgM negative. Then we can discharge the patient. So I think everything is clear for you. Thank you so much for your patient listening. I know it's a little bit heavy stuff, but if you understand it clearly, it's very interesting actually, because there is no rocket science in that. Only thing, you should understand the fundamentals of this one, how a virus gets into the body. So once a virus comes, what our immune system is doing. So that's only thing to be known. Like, so what is IgG? I hope I have explained everything clearly. How IgM is developing. IgM is immediate reaction. then followed by the IgG. IgG is persisting in the body as memory cells. We have different types of memory cells. Either it can be CD4 plus or CD8 plus. Some will be persisting throughout the life. Like if you contracted chickenpox, the IgG will be there forever. So if you get an infection, you will have an IgG. Or if you are vaccinated, you will get IgG. But if you are not infected, if you are not vaccinated, you will not get IgG. So if you get an IgG patient after 6 months with SARS-CoV-2, that means he is infected with SARS-CoV-2 and is completely cured, because there is no vaccination so far, so it will not come. So before ending, I am going to give you a box of chocolates, I mean sweets. You can identify these three sweets. Who first give me the right answer? I think Dr. Anu will give you a latest apple, no? He offered a latest apple for the winner. So moving to that picture, it's a box of sweets. Identify these three sweets.
Two, three. RBC, coronavirus. Two and that.
Is RBC who answered that? RBC who answered that? Okay, two. What is two? Two then. So one is RBC. Any other answers? I think Dr. Tasni is there now. Our Ayurveda doctor, she can answer. Or any other person to answer? You can send the answer to the RBC Putin. Sorry, wrong. Dr. Sheeta Nikam. No. And can you? Body disturbance is there. One is RBC. Yeah, we got the RBC. Then the other two. Any wild guess?
Third is corona. Third one is corona.
One is RBC, two and three?
Corona.
Third one is corona.
It's not corona. I have shown you the corona picture, no? Two and three, do you want any clue? Not corona. If it is RBC, then what are the other 2%?
Time is less than 1 minute.
Doctor Safwan,
time is less than 1 minute, please. First, make it fast.
You are correct to the answer. One is RBC. Exactly. Very good. Doctor Ashwini, you are correct. Two is platelet and three is RBC platelet lymphocyte. Think the can you mute Dr. Anu?
Sure. Yes. Yeah.
Anything you can ask me. I express my gratitude to all the doctors, especially from Ayurveda, Siddha, Yunani, and Homeopathy. And if you want, you can just inform us. We will conduct more classes on different topics. I think with this, we can end coronavirus, COVID diseases. You can just go through